I truly believe that as we do these things and we lift up a praise, a governing climate of praise and worship and exalting, he's enthroned in our praise. As we lift him up and he governs the territory that we're in, be it our schools, our workplaces, our church, our streets, as we do that, he said the enemy will stand still. He will be paralyzed. We will literally bind him with the ropes of praise. He will stand there and we're going to go in and get the sinner out, and there's nothing he can do about it. Give God a praise. Give him a clap offering. Our works will not be in vain. We are going to be a governing church. You don't think that summer soak is for nothing? We're inspiring ourselves. We've heard some tremendous praise. You know, it's even awesome. Even the drums prophesied. Even the drums. We don't even go there. I'm just telling you what comes from your lips. We haven't even touched the fire. Why do you say God said praise him in this harp? Praise him with the drums. Praise him with the singing. Praise him with the clap. You understand? Everything that has breath. Everything. If he tells the inanimate thing to praise him, what about the animate thing?
This is GBC Web TV. On the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Deliberate Purposeful Worship by Pastor Celia Apeagyei-Collins.
Many people here won't know anything about you at all. So could you just say just a little bit about your ministry, what God's calling on your life is? And I'm going to ask you another question or two. Then I'm going to pray for you. Then I'm going to go and sit down and leave you to bring God's word to us this morning.
I used to pastor for many years and was a dean of Bible college until God called me to do itinerant work. So now what I do is I preach in different nations of the world, about 20-something different nations, as God sends me. And I specialize in leadership development, vision development. I love to come alongside pastors and help churches grow and to just point people to Jesus. I also run a mentoring network for leaders. And do a whole lot of other things just to change community and to be a good ambassador for Jesus Christ.
Well, it's a privilege to have you here this morning. Let's talk to God, shall we? Father God, you have been with us already this morning. You have touched our lives. You have spoken to us. And now we thank you for your servant, Pastor Celia, coming and being among us today. And Father, we ask now for herself, your spirit to anoint her, to fill her, to flood her, for your word to come through her into us. And for ourselves this morning, we ask a similar thing. We ask that your spirit will come upon us. For you'll give us attentive minds and listening hearts, that you will speak into our lives, into our situations, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor David. I must say, there is no other place that drummers are as good as this church. Excuse me. It's very hard to sit down and not just do some moves. It's just wonderful. I love the spirit in the house. It's not formal. It's a bit of method to your madness. And it's so wonderful. I'm really excited to be here because I heard the word Baptist, and that's all I could focus on, Baptist. Have mercy, Jesus. I said, help me to behave, because normally I misbehave. But it's good to see that I'm home. Yes. I'm on people just like myself. You know what I mean? We're going to start out with a little bit of worship again, simply because it's part of my mandate to teach on deliberate, purposeful worship. I tell people, don't sing a song. There's no such thing as singing a song per se. There's everything as communicating. 2 Samuel chapter 22. We just read it. I'm reading from the King James. But just in case you can't read King James English, I've got an NIV close at hand. 2 Samuel chapter 22. Thank you once again, Pastor David. Thank you. I love your spirit. You know, when I was coming, I just had a feeling of deja vu. I felt I'd been here before. I still swear I've been here before, years ago, to a women's meeting. Do you have a women's thing here? There's a lot of sitting around a table. This is many, many years ago. Or maybe I'm just being prophetic. That means inviting myself back. Are you in 2 Samuel 22? Then David spoke to the Lord the words of this song on the day when the Lord had delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, the God of my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold, my refuge, my savior. You save me from violence. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Surely shall I be saved from my enemies." It's not my main text today, but I just wanted to, since you love worship, and there's such an inspired worship in this place. But listen, the Bible starts by saying, David spoke to the Lord. Some of your translations may say, he sang all the words of this song to the Lord. In other words, you never sing, you're communicating. Every time you sing, whether it's a slow song or a fast song, whether you're in the shower, cooking, or church, or the local assembly like this, you are communicating to an entity. You're not enjoying music, but in God's goodness, every time you do something God wants you to do, you enjoy it too. But you're communicating. I want you to have a consciousness of communicating. So he said he sang the words of this song to the Lord. The melody was accompanying the words of David. The words of David were meant for God's ears. But by the way, every time you sing a song, you're actually communicating to four entities. You're communicating, first of all, to God. You're communicating to your own soul. How many of you, when you turn, see, it's very hard not to smile. You know, just as you're thinking, he turned my mourning into dancing again. You do it instinctively. Your body begins to move. A smile comes on your face because suddenly hope comes. Suddenly you see transformed situation and immediately your face begins to light up. So remember, you forget this, but you're communicating to yourself too. You're also communicating to your neighbor. Have you ever watched somebody worship and you just felt inspired? I mean, I was looking at you this morning. Yeah, my sister, she had her hands up. I was watching the lady. She's gone. She had a lovely green thing. I mean, I just love her moves. No, it's true. But also, the Bible says, the humble will hear thereof and be glad. Remember, something life, full of life, something energetic, something with authority, something powerful is leaving your lips. Somebody is listening. It has a power to affect. See, you didn't realize how powerful you were. You don't have to be laying hands on people right here to be powerful. Every time you open your mouth, you turn my mourning, you let it rain. My goodness, you even forgot that you're commanding something from heaven to change somebody's life. That's power. You don't need to hold a microphone to be powerful. You're powerful. As long as, I say to myself, as long as God lives inside of me, don't mess with me. I'm powerful. That's why, no, listen, you forget, I'm serious. Even Jesus said, he said, bless and don't curse. Think about it a little bit. There is power upon your tongue. If you curse, nothing would happen. Do you think he would have admonished you not to curse? And then if you blessed and nothing happened, would he encourage you to bless? You have power. Literally, somebody's destiny is in somebody's mouth this afternoon. You're communicating to yourself. You're communicating to your neighbor. They hear and something happens in their lives. You may not believe this, but trust the word of the Lord. Number three, you're communicating to God. The Bible says, you know this, he's enthroned in your praise. You know, I like the psalmist, Psalm 65, I think he says this. He says, praise awaits you in Zion. To you who hears prayer, will all flesh come. It's almost like you are wooing God. Man, you didn't think he was the lover of your soul. Most of us look to God as father and protector. We forget he's also a lover. You're betrothed to him as a church, and I am the church, you are the church. He is the lover. You know, we're going to consummate that in whatever way he wants up there someday, sometime. But it's time to handle yourself like you're a bride. You're a bride in a bridal gown with, what do they call the army boots? Combat boots on, thank you. You know, and that's exactly what the church looks like. A bride with combat boots. So you're warring, but you're also loving your lover. Thankfully, the gown covers the boots. But you know, we forget to woo God. And I like Psalm 45. Come there with me. It's one of my favorite psalms. Otherwise, we get into automatic with this thing. Otherwise, we wait for somebody to entertain us. And we really forget what we're doing. Psalm 45 says this: my heart is overflowing with a good theme. I recite my composition concerning the king. My tongue is the pen of the ready writer. This is not meant for the preacher. This is meant for the worshiper. He says, I can't wait. I can't wait. I can't wait. I can't wait to give you praise. This guy knows how to woo. So those of you who come from Nigeria, to toast or to chirp, you know, he has words. He really knows how to give it to God. And sometimes we forget that you're coming to a lover. And when you approach your lover, you don't make demands. There's just some things he has to hear first. She has to hear first. You understand? Show me the money, says the girls. You know, you don't just come with mouth when you're wooing. Is that your wife? She is, yes. He didn't just come to you with mouth and all talk. You have to do something. And I love this son of Korah. He says, listen, I've made my composition ready. I'm challenging you this morning. He said, when I went to the king, I wasn't trying to fumble for words. I didn't think, oh, I bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. He said, no, I really prepared my composition. I rehearsed this thing. We've all written compositions in our lives before. I remember a day in the marketplace or a day in the life of all. You know, describe a scene. You think about it. You think about your introduction. You think about your conclusion. And then you put the body in. This thing is put together deliberately. It's like a poem. You know, the words have to rhyme. You're sending out a certain message. You don't want it to be misunderstood. You don't want it to be underestimated. You really put thought and soul and heart into this thing. He said, before I went to the house of the Lord, I made my composition ready. Before I got into my closet with God, I really knew what I was going to say to him. Did you prepare a composition before you came this morning? You know, everything you're singing is somebody else's composition. That wasn't put together in 2.5 minutes. Can guarantee you. For many songwriters, it's been cooking inside of them for years. It's an inspired place. They might write it, they might visit it. I'm challenging you. Please don't treat God like he's your mate. We're too casual with him. There's such a joy and a pleasure when you make your composition. And then he comes to God and he says, you are fairer than 10,000 men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has truly blessed you forever. Gird your sword upon your thigh, O mighty one, with your glory and your majesty. This guy is giving it to God. When was the last time you really gave it to God? I know it's a Baptist church, but smile a little bit so I know. When was the last time you gave it to God? When was the last time you sat down? The beauty about the Bible is if you can't make up your own words, borrow them. David will help you. Solomon will help you. The Psalms will help you. I'm not saying repeat them. If you repeat their words, make sure it's sincere. All I'm trying to say is worship is very purposeful. Very deliberate. Something you've thought about. Something you've sat down and thought, what am I going to say to Jesus today? Lord, you're so good. You're so good to me. You know, one of my favorite songs, he says, were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all. It's a composition. I sat down. I may not be the original author of those words, but they mean something to me. This morning, what does it mean to you? This morning, what does Jesus mean to you? Find words to tell him. It's good that he saved you. Sometimes we look back. And we're forever grateful. You understand what I'm saying? So this guy made up his composition. What's your composition? I'm challenging you to go back home and put together a composition. In the morning, just say 2 minutes. What am I going to say to my father today? You've been good to me. Look at the children. They wake up. They run from their bedroom. Mom, I love you. Sometimes they don't ask anything. Every time, we are so used to asking. Let me tell you, daddy has a duty of care whether you ask him or not. He really does. He has a duty of care. Your asking doesn't change God. Your asking affirms the fact that you believe he's who he says he is and will do everything he says he will do. And I'm sure he prefers to hear, I love you. I thank you. I'm so grateful. Then he does. Give me. Give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. Because after all, he said, there's no word upon your tongue altogether. He knows it before you ask. It's always waiting. His grace, his goodness, his mercy abound towards you. I wanted to encourage you. The last person, the last audience, if you like, for your communicated song is the devil. I like that because I discovered something. He doesn't like this thing. I'm going to give it to him. Oh, I've decided you're going to stay away from me. Because every time you come, I will zap you with this thing. Do you know that the Bible says he gives you even, oh, I don't want to get into that, a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. See, this is what I intended to preach and I changed it. You know, for a spirit of heaviness, even your praise becomes a garment. It becomes an identification for you. It becomes something, but look at what Isaiah says. If he liked the spirit of heaviness upon you, would he replace your garment? And yet, we don't like to feel heavy, but we create circumstances for heaviness to stay. If I came to you and you were weeping, I say, please don't cry. God is going to do this. Let's just praise God together. It's like you look at me askew like this. She doesn't really know what I'm going through. Because for most of us, praise is just something we do when we feel good. But he says, especially when you're heavy, change your clothes. Daddy says, you don't quite look sexy. Still lover, right? It's allowed in a Baptist church, is it? Yeah. Okay, it's a good word. Okay. You don't like quite look how I want you to look in those heavy clothes. Change them. Put something else on. Reposition yourself. I like that new garment. It's called a garment of praise. It lifts off something. There is power within you. There is power in your tongue. Why do I say all these things? Because we're going out there to change a world, and if we are uncertain about our own walk with God, we don't have the confidence to change our world. I am telling you this. I realize that the Bible says in Joshua chapter 2 that Joshua sent out spies to spy out Canaan. And Rahab said something very important. Let's go there quickly for 2 minutes. Now Joshua the son of Nun sent out 2 men from Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of harlot king named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out the country. Anyway, Rahab hid them when the king was chasing after them. But before they went to sleep, verse 8, now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know, listen, this is the enemy. This is the person whose land you're going to take. This is the person whose power you're going to overcome and drive out to possess your inheritance. She comes to you and says, I know that God has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. How many of you would like to hear the devil tell that to you? Now, we've been listening to a whole lot of nonsense he's been telling us. You're a failure. You're never going to make it. I'm going to get you. You're never going to get that job. Imagine how much time we give listening to something that is not the voice of God. But this is different. And this is what I want to hear. The enemy come to me and say, listen, I know that you have everything that God has promised you. You may not in a reality touch it right now, but it's still yours because something is happening inside of me. She said, all the inhabitants of this land are faint-hearted. We don't have any energy, strength, power to fight you because we're scared of you. Why? Verse 10. Because we heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. We heard what you did to the 2 kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og. They had a reputation that nobody could destroy them. But we heard what a mess you did with them. Now, hang on a minute. This is a bunch of slaves. This is not a great army. This is not a trained army. This is not even an army with a reputation who are really making mincemeat out of men of repute, Sihon and Og. You utterly destroyed them. As soon as we heard these things, our hearts melted inside of us. There didn't remain any courage in anyone because of you. Why? Because the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on beneath. Imagine you're going to fight a war and your enemy comes to tell you this. I'm actually very scared of you. In fact, I look very intimidating, but the truth of the matter is, inside of me, I've given up the fight. You got to remember that Joshua 6 says, Jericho, which they were going to take, is tightly shut up. Nobody goes in, nobody comes out. They're under siege. They put themselves under siege because of you. They're scared of you. I came to tell you good gospel news. There's an enemy that's really scared of you. He is really scared of you. The only thing is you got to switch on another frequency to hear what he's saying. She said, we heard certain things concerning you and we were afraid. How did they hear? Exodus chapter 15 tells us this, that as they went along the cities, the villages, the towns, they sang praise. Moses led them in praise of what God had done from when they left Egypt. Miriam led the woman with a tambourine, singing and dancing. What were they doing? It tells me singing isn't just something you do. Their testimony was being sung. Exodus 15. Are you there? Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. Just to satisfy you, I'm reading from the NIV. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. Listen to this music. This is testimony. What is your testimony? It's not every day that you have occasion to stand here and say what God have done. I went to medical school. Thank God for when children are laying wayside and when teenagers are being killed, that we have some stalwart leaders in the house who are in medical school making it big time without compromise. Growing in the Lord day by day. You know, that is a testimony. For me, I sat there. I was so proud of that girl. As she passed by me, I just hesitated because I was just going to say to her, we are proud of you. It's testimony that it works in the church. This is proof positive that when our young people come to God, they won't be slaughtering themselves out on the streets there. It may be nothing to you, but it's something to me. You understand, it's not just about her passing the exams. This is somebody also in the future that the anointing of healing is going to flow through to those who come to hospitals. When medicine fails, God's power is going to flow through her. When she looks at patients and where other people fail, by the grace of God, by the Spirit of God, she's able to be able to diagnose right. How many people are going to be delivered out of the mouth of the grave because of that young lady? That's a testimony right there. It's a good place to say amen. He said, I will sing to the Lord. No, amen just means that's a good statement. I don't do that because I want you to clap for me as a preacher. Oh, I don't hype people up that way. It just means it's a good statement. I agree. Let it be that way and nothing else. Even Paul says, if you speak in tongues and you keep speaking and nobody understands you, how can they say amen and come into agreement and pull into their lives what you say? He said, I will sing to the Lord, Moses said, for he's highly exalted. He said, let me tell you about my God. I like attitude in worship. Because I'm proud. The Bible says, you make your boast in the Lord. He said, the horse and its rider, he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength, my song. He has become our salvation. He is our God, and we will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. He said, don't mess with us Israelites, because our Lord is a warrior. And Adonai is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his armies, he has hurled into the sea. Now you see what Moses is doing? He's beginning to tell the story of what happened to them. He's making up his own composition here. The best of Pharaoh's officers are drowned in the Red Sea. He says, you want to mess with us? Check out our history. Ooh, next time the devil comes to you, you say, you want to mess with me? Check out my history. And just begin to make your own melody. Your song is not perfected till it reaches God's ears. Years ago, I went for when I was in Bible college, I went for audition for the choir. And I remember moaning and groaning and complaining because I knew really I wasn't going to pass that audition, but I so wanted to be in the choir. And the music director made a statement that he said, some of you, we know that God is delighted in everybody singing. He said, some of you, only God can enjoy your music. And others, people on earth can enjoy. He said, but right now we're not in heaven yet. So we only need people that both parties can enjoy. And that eliminated me. But I'll have you know, for all you, my enemies who are laughing, I did make the choir. He wasn't listening then, I'm sure. He said, the deep waters have covered them. They sank to the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, you're majestic in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy. Listen, the enemy is listening. Moses is talking about this stuff. The enemy is listening. He says, God, you unleashed your burning anger. It consumed them like stubble by the blast. In every town, every village they went through, people were hearing this thing about your God. Let the enemy hear. We are spirit people. There are spirit beings out there. I like songs. I call them To Whom It May Concern. Let me send it out there. If you're listening, hear me. It's true. And then some of the songs that we sing, I think are like anthems of heaven. How great thou art. Ooh, how can you sing that song without pushing your chest out, head back, and saluting? It is true. Let me tell you something. You think, oh, maybe we ought to wait because of worship day. You think that you just sing a song? Remember when you watch the Olympics, there are countries you never heard of, couldn't even spell their names. And how many of you tell the truth? Yeah? We never heard of those countries till we watched the Olympics. We didn't even know they existed out of the 220 countries in the world. And those countries, you know, they always win things that you wouldn't even thought of those sports as existing too. But you know, whether you agree or not, whether you like them or not, whether you recognize their flag or the sport or not, as soon as they get on that podium and their national anthems begin to be played, everybody's got to salute. Everybody's got to honor. You don't understand the power of anthems. We have an anthem. How great thou art, O Ancient of Days. One of my favorite songs is that one that talks about, it's not Ancient of Days. He talks about, oh, it's gone out of my head. I'll remember it in a bit. That's the beauty of being at home. You can be yourself, right? I don't know everything, just some things. But you know, I just love it. Maybe your favorite song talks about the majesty of God, reveals the majesty of God. It humbles you because you think this awesome God should touch me, to so love me, to come to live inside of me. I'm telling you, I love to worship. I love to praise. There's so many dynamics to it and everything is happening. But like I'm saying, when they play that anthem, somebody responds a certain way. People stop what they're doing. They take their hats off. They put their hand on their chest. They salute. Well, do out your anthem. Sing out your anthem about your God, about the kingdom that you come from. And I can guarantee you there are entities out there that respond to the anthem that you sing. And Moses is singing his anthem. He said in verse 9, the enemy boasted. He said, I will pursue. I will overtake them. I will divide their spoil. He has a plan concerning you, to kill you, to steal, to destroy from you, to destroy your community. But God also has another plan. Verse 10, but God blew with his breath. The sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Verse 11 is what I'm coming to. Moses says, so God, who among you, who among the gods is exactly like you? Who is like you? You are majestic in your holiness. You are awesome in your glory, working wonders. The King James says, you're majestic in your holiness. You are fearful in praise, working wonders. How many of you, when you were praising God today, wanted to hide under the chair? None of us did. None of us did. In fact, the more we praise God and we sang those wonderful songs, the more we wanted to embrace him. The more he was there, we'd give him a kiss on both cheeks. The more we wanted to be drawn into God. The more we wanted to prolong this worship. But the Bible says somebody is fearful when you praise him. And it's not you. It's got to be somebody else. Yeah. Whether you do it in the bath or not, somebody is listening. And that person is fearful. I'm telling you. Now you understand why Jehoshaphat would send, God would tell him, send your sound before you. Send your sound before you. Why? Because something happens when you do. Something awesome, something glorious. There's a battle raging in the heavens. You haven't even lifted a finger yet. Oh, yes, you have. Your song, your praise is your weapon. It's affecting something concerning you. If there's a siege thing around you, it's got to fall away. If the darkness is coming, it's got to give way to the light. But I'm telling you, there's no impartiality when true praise leaves your heart, is expressed through your lips, and it reaches the heavens. Something happens. There's never a stalemate in that kind of condition. He says, you are fearful in praise, the God who doeth wonders. You stretch out your right hand, and the earth swallowed them. You don't believe me? Verse 14, everybody read now with me. The nations will hear what you've done and tremble. Excuse me, which nations? He's talking about the nations that are opposing them on their way to possessing Canaan. They will hear, and what will happen? They will tremble. Anguish will grip the people of Philistine. Philistine was an entity. In the 21st century, we'll call Philistine a demon, a principality, a power. You do believe that, don't you? Yeah. Okay. The chiefs of Edom was one of those. They will be terrified. The leaders of Moab will be seized with trembling. He's talking about what happens to principalities. I challenge you, Greenford Baptist. It's time for the principalities to know there's a church here governed by Yahweh, by the Almighty God, by the Great I Am. It's time to take back our territory. It's time to put a boundary around this territory. It's time to know that you don't cross. You better, when you get here, entity, wherever you are from, you're going to have to pass over. Don't mess with this church. Don't mess with us. Don't mess. This is our area. You understand? I'm encouraging you. When you leave home and you're going to the bus stop, it don't take all that to send a praise song into the heavens. Everybody's on duty 24/7. You know what? You can use it to soften the ground for evangelism, to break holds that are on areas for a long time. I'm not talking an impossibility. I'm saying that no farmer goes and throws seeds on the ground until he's worked the ground. Every area has a ruling government. That ruling government will be expressed through what happens in the area. I don't know much about Greenford, but I know the God who governs Greenford, and I know that by all means, wherever God governs Greenford, there'll be an entity that opposes what God wants to do. And I'm saying when you lift up your praise, you set up another heaven over the area. Are you understanding what I'm saying? You will set up... Is there anybody who can't do that every day? You can even change the climate in your own home. Climates are interesting things. Atmospheres are very interesting things. Climates are actually congealed atmospheres. They determine what grows in any area. We're in real trouble today because I've left my notes. They determine what grows in any area. I come from Ghana. When I first came to the United Kingdom and I went to Sainsbury, they had exotic fruit. I mean, I was keen to get my hand on those exotic fruit. I had never seen a kiwi before in my life, never mind pomegranates. As ugly as sin, but tasting good. I mean, I had never seen any of these fruit before. But I got there and there's mango, and I'm like, hang on a minute. There ain't nothing exotic about mango. Because where I come from, it's to a penny. I don't eat mango. The reason I don't eat mango is I went to boarding school from the age of 11. And we were surrounded by mango trees. And, you know, you starve at boarding school. You really do starve at boarding school. Anybody from Ghana here? Now, this is a real church. We found one or two. They have Ghanaians. It's a real church. If you didn't have them, it wouldn't be quite the same thing. But, you know, and I'm like, where I come from, we didn't even... pick from the ground. You had to throw. And once you threw a stone, 6 mangoes would fall. So what is so exotic about this mango? Coconuts. I'm serious. Coconuts. You know, it's the cheapest thing. And they're calling it exotic until I realize it's because it doesn't grow here. Now, there's excellent soil in the UK. Wonderful scientists. Everything is fine. I'm sure they can produce a great seed. If they are cloning human beings, they can do it. But you know one thing they can't do? They can't grow the common coconut. Why? Because the climate is wrong. Sila, pause. Think about it a little bit. What you're trying to grow in Greenford, the seed of the word may be right. You have experts at knowing how to speak the word. But when the climate is all wrong, you can't grow it. That's why when they want to grow it, they grow it in what? A greenhouse, where it is a controlled, deliberately put atmosphere or climate to help that thing germinate. All I'm asking you to do in Greenford is put another climate in place. Are you ready? Can you put another climate in place? Through your worship, let it be a principle that you follow in your own home. Put another climate in place. Pastor, how much time do I have left? I didn't look at what time I started. 12:40, okay, thank you. Put another climate in place. Is that difficult or is that easy? How many of you are going to do that? Every day, in your own home, in your workplace. It just takes 5 minutes, 10 minutes. You even do it subconsciously. But you know what? If once it becomes an everyday habit, that's your bit of warfare. It becomes easier to do. Your testimonies are going to be great because one thing I know is that God watches over his word to perform it. Listen to what Moses says here in verse 16. He says, terror, as we praise you, God, terror and dread will fall upon them by the power of your arm. They will become as still as stone until your people pass by. God says when you praise him and you express his greatness and you make your boast about him and you praise him with your testimony, this is what happens to your enemies. They become fearful. They are immobilized by fear. We know that as an English phrase. They are paralyzed by fear. They are unable to do anything to you. And he says, they will stand still until you pass over. I truly believe that as we do these things and we lift up a praise, a governing climate of praise and worship and exalting, he's enthroned in our praise. As we lift him up and he governs the territory that we're in, be it our schools, our workplaces, our church, our streets, as we do that, he said, the enemy will stand still. He will be paralyzed. We will literally bind him with the ropes of praise. He will stand there and we're going to go in and get the sinner out, and there's nothing he can do about it. Give God a praise. Give him a clap offering. Our works will not be in vain. We are going to be a governing church. You don't think that summer soak is for nothing. We're inspiring ourselves. We've heard some tremendous praise. You know, it's even awesome. Even the drums prophesied. Even the drums. We don't even go there. I'm just telling you what comes from your lips. We haven't even touched the fire. Why do you say God said praise him in this harp? Praise him with the drums. Praise him with the singing. Praise him with the clap. You understand? Everything that has breath. Everything. If he tells the inanimate thing to praise him, what about the animate thing? I've abandoned my preaching for today, so we're staying with this. Do you know, I did. I tell you something. I really prayed this morning. I have hardly slept, calling on God ever since I've had the funny enough, the first day that I had the invitation, I hadn't before, after I prayed about it, I felt like share about worship and praise. Then I put it aside. And all these few weeks, I've just been struggling. I've been there. And I settled for something else this morning. But I'm going to settle back into this. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you following?
Yeah.
Are we in agreement?
Yeah.
I don't know what you're going to do, but I just know God is going to produce some really wild people from this church.
Amen.
Who are really going to do this and change our nation. 1 Corinthians 14. Oh, you know, even by the way, the psalmist says, praise looks good on you. Praise just looks good. It fits right on you. 1 Corinthians 14. Listen to what Paul has to say. But now, brethren, verse 6, if I come to you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you unless I speak to you either by revelation, by knowledge, by prophesying, or by teaching? Even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sounds, how will it be known what is being piped or played? He said when you praise, there must be a distinction. That distinction is the faith, is the purposefulness by which you praise. Do you praise because the song is going good? Oh, shit. Yes, which one was that? I just want to say. I did warn you. Baba, oh, was it the rhythm that was making you move? Or was it a gratefulness of heart? Father, I just want to thank you. If it had not been the Lord who was on my side, it's time for you now to begin to reflect. See, maybe you may not have time to, in the next 2 minutes, while the song was going on, to sing everything that God had done for you. But by golly, somebody had compressed those words. But you have to focus on the gratitude of God, of what God has done. You know, the other day, God just showed me how he can be with us and how he can do wonderful things. Isaiah said, don't remember the former things because I do a new thing. He's awesome in your life. He's with you. And sometimes you forget that. I went to an embassy. Normally, I use an agency for that embassy for my visa. And then they stopped taking agency things, I think because of terrorism and so on. Now they want to see you in person. But I got there and they said, I was in the queue. And they said, well, we have seen 60 people already. How can you see 60 people already? The embassy opens at 8:30. This is 9:52. And they say they only see 60 people. Meanwhile, I'm like number 85. So I'm standing there thinking, okay. And the man warns us, we're not going to do anything. You better go home. Then we're standing there. So the man just says, okay, we're going to inspect your documents. Those of you we're not going to see. We're going to just see that your documents are okay and you have to come in tomorrow. I don't have time to come in tomorrow. Besides, I've only got 2 days to leave for this country and I need my visa now. If I don't put the visa in, it was a Wednesday. I leave the country on Saturday morning. If I don't put the visa in on Wednesday, it means I don't get my passport back on Friday. It means I can't go on this thing. The people had advertised a nationwide thing. I've got to go. So unbelieving me stands there and think, okay, who else can I recommend to them? Oh, God, I'm going to be really in trouble. My mom is going to nag me. Everybody's going to nag me. And, you know, all negative things. And suddenly I'm calm. I'm calm. Watch it when God puts a calmness inside your heart when trouble begins. I'm standing here and I'm thinking, okay, shall I go back to the office? Shall I stay? I don't know why I didn't go. I just felt like going at 10 and I stayed at 10. I'm telling you, thank God that when I'm weak, he's strong. When I'm foolish, he's wise. I'm telling you, he's near. He's as near as your breath. He's as near as a mere thought away. I'm standing there anyway. The man comes and says, okay, we're going to inspect documents up to this lady, but none of you are going to have your visas, your applications accepted. I said, fine. I said, I've been to this country lots of times, over the years, maybe 20 times, 30 times. I don't really need my documents inspected. I know I've got everything, but I stayed in the queue. When he got to me, he just looked and he looked and he looked. And then I said, he said, where's this? And I said, well, it's here and it's here. And then I said, but I've got to go on Saturday. You know, I leave the country on Saturday. I don't know what I'm going to do. He just looked at me and he shoved some. I had prepared my tongue to argue. He just shocked. I really had. I didn't know which way I was going to go. I was very self-conscious because there were other people around whose papers were being inspected. And then he shoved something in my hand and just shoved me in a room. And I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm going to take your visa application. You what? I am the last person. Remember, he has turned everybody away. I didn't even put my case in. Excuse me, God, give me a chance to put my case in so I can say I called upon the Lord and he heard me. But I didn't even get to put my case in. I sat there. I was stunned. It was surreal. I couldn't believe it. I kept wanting to hide. I kept thinking, maybe another official is going to say, you are a fraud. What are you doing here? We've closed the queue long time, an hour before your application was taken. I sat there. I was in a daze. Do you know what? All I wanted to do was crawl somewhere, get on my knees, bow and say, Father, I just give you praise. I honor you. You are just awesome. I came to tell you the God who you serve is the one who even controls people's hearts and minds. He turns them. The Bible says the hearts of kings are in the hands of God. He can turn them this way. He can turn them that way. I don't know what impossible situation that you have this morning, but I came to tell you I know a God who can. I know a God who is in control. You know, I know a God who you don't even have to ask. He can do it. I'm like, God, you preceded me. When the Bible says goodness and mercy follow you, I'm telling you, it goes ahead of you. What he's trying to say is, it's really in attendance to you. You get there, they said no to everybody. They look at your face. They don't know why, but they're opening a door and shoving you in before you can even put your application in. I am telling you, how can I not make my boast? So if this morning I see Mary Grace crazy and I'm dancing and I'm saying adukpe, you understand when I say thank you. Baba, I am so grateful because you know what? I know what you have done. I know what you can do. I know whom I have with me. I know when I don't deserve it, you do it, God. Because it was my fault for not putting it in on time. But there's a God whose mercy overrides my mistake. The songwriter says he looks beyond my fault and he saw my need. When I'm standing to praise him, I'm supposed to bring this picture, this memory of his goodness and his mercy. I'm supposed to get on my knee. Today, people don't even kneel when they praise God. It's an effort for you to put up your hand. You know why? Because you're singing a song. You're not recounting a testimony. A testimony is not just something God has done. A testimony is bearing witness to who he is. David says, you are my God, so I will praise you. Ha! who am I in heaven but you, O God? But look what kind of God I have. He rolls back the waters of the mighty Red Sea. When men go fishing and there is no fish, he commands and says, you go out there, come out with fish. He's the Lord of all creation. He's got fish right there in the sea, and he knows how to command them to come to my net. I don't know what impossible situation you face, but I can guarantee you, sometimes we have no faith because we don't know how to worship. I dare you this morning to truly worship in spirit and in truth. Paul says we are the circumcision who worship not God in the flesh, not out of a carnal religious thing that we ought to do, but who worship God in spirit. We're connected. He's so real to us. Worship makes him real to us. I dare you to worship him in a reality as though he's real. I dare you in your own worship time to recount his mercy, his goodness, to sing about his awesome greatness, awesome power, to sing about the power of covenant, and come out of your prayer closet still down. I dare you. I dare you. This is God who you serve. Every time God comes to a man, he introduces himself, says, I'm the God of Abraham, I'm the God of Isaac, I'm the God of Jacob. You know why? Check me out. He said, check out my record. He said, I don't want you to take me at face value. Check out my track record. Go ask Abraham how he gave birth. Not one son, lots of babies. When, naturally speaking, he was past it. Go check out my record. Go check out my record that I am a God who watches over his word to perform. Oh, by the way, in case you didn't know, ask Isaac. Why do you think he introduces himself? It's to let you know what he's done. It's to let you know what he's going to do. He said, go ask Isaac. Ask him when there was a credit crunch. Oh, yes, there was. The Bible calls it a famine. In Gerar. Ask him if I did not attend to his needs by telling him how to position himself. I told him, don't move from Gerar. Stay right there. I'll prosper you. I'm telling you, there's a credit crunch all around. You better build yourself a sanctuary. And I don't mean a human-built one. You better put another government over your mind and your heart. You better know that there's a credit crunch out there, but I don't exist in that kingdom. I live in another kingdom. That kingdom might as well be real to you. I'm telling you, when they say there's no money somewhere, money is shifting into somebody's hands. And why don't I have it? No, I'm telling you. Why not me? Why not into my hands? I'm telling you that, you know what? The media has become a false prophetic voice. When you are a Christian, you don't govern your life by what the media says. See, by a lot of us are not in contact with headquarters enough. What worship does, it opens channels. It opens channels. As I communicate my praise, he communicates instructions back. He settles me. You watch our old patriarchs and our fathers. They always built an altar of worship. What were they doing? They were sending out their incense of praise. They're saying, you are my God. You're still God. You have not changed. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. I particularly want to talk about the credit crunch because, you see, you're going to make decisions because of what is being said. You better be grounded in God enough. When they say, Pastor David, there's no money, I say, I understand that. But you got to understand, my kingdom that I belong to has another system of economy. Amen. Let me tell you something. Oh, they are lying, 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 they are lying. In the book of Acts, when Paul began to preach the gospel, the Bible says that the businessmen rose up, led by Demetrius. They were upset. They sought to kill Paul. Why? They said, because we are losing money. I asked myself, money doesn't hang in the air. When it leaves the hand of idolaters and gamblers and pornographers and drug dealers, it's got to settle somewhere. Perhaps they saw that Christian businessmen were rising up. Their businesses were blooming. Their homes were blooming. They had more than enough because he's El Shaddai God. It had to land somewhere. So they sought them to kill them and to put them in prison and beat them up. I understand. When you preach the gospel, did you know that there is power in the gospel not just to affect men's hearts, but to affect the climate and the economy? Oh, you didn't hear me. You don't believe me. I'm just excited. I really am excited. I say, credit crunch, thank you. God, I don't want a credit crunch. But one thing I know God told me, he says, lift up a praise. And I'm going to hold a praise event just for credit crunch. We're going to put another system in place. For our nation, God have mercy. Unless we rise up and do something, we rise up and do something. In Israel's hardest, darkest hour, they always praised. They always praised. This year is a new year. Let your sound go ahead of you. I believe in the year 08. It's a different kind of year. Something, a cycle has ended. Seven, we know, in biblical numerology, is the and I'm not one to make big thing, really big thing out of numbers, but the reality is we live in a shifting of seasons. Seasons are real. And when seasons come, you adapt to the season and flow with the season. And so seven is a year of completion. But it's not just something has ended, a cycle has ended. When a cycle ends and another begins, you better not ignore the cycle that has ended. When you put your things in the wash and a cycle ends, you don't leave it there just because it's ended. You pull it out, you hang it out, you press it, and you wear it. Imagine this, because you know I'm getting to like mangoes a little bit these days. But imagine this. When a mango goes through a cycle and it ends, what happens to it? It's ripe for the eating. Can I say to you, your mango is ripe for the eating? Amen. We've entered another cycle. We've entered another season. That's why I'm not so much listening to the credit crunch. I am aware of a credit crunch. Because of that, I'm upping my prayer, my praise, my giving, my obedience. I'm upping my sensitivity to hear the instructions of heaven. Because of that, I refuse to be dampened. I'm thinking, opportunity. I really am. Oh, I'm telling you, this year I've made up my mind. I'm going to be wealthy, twice as wealthy as I was this year. Oh, you know why? It's not to spend it on fancy things. I'm thinking of all those children that are starving in Africa. Somebody's got to look after them. Somebody's got to send money for the orphanages. Somebody's going to send money to look after the poor. Somebody's going to send money for those kids whose parents don't allow them to go to school because they've got to work to bring in an income for the household. I feel like I want to pay the fees, pay the parents off, and say, allow them to go to school. Anybody with me this morning? You understand. That's why you cannot let the credit crunch affect you. If you let it affect you, who is going to represent Jesus in looking after the poor? Besides, when there was another credit crunch, I can tell you, God showed it. It's true. Yes, it's going to be a credit crunch. After all, I don't deny that. After all, in the days of Joseph, God showed Pharaoh through the dream about the seven bulls, the 7 years of plenty, and the 7 years of lack. But it took the church to interpret it, called Joseph. See, governments know, they can tell when seasons change. They can tell when money doesn't go good. They can tell when things are coming. God has given them, because we are made in the image of God, they have prophetic ability. But they don't have solution. That's why we need the money. That's why we need to be okay in these times. Because we are the ones that are going to give them a solution. Joseph got up, went to Pharaoh, and gave him a 14-year economic plan. Saved the whole Asiatic nation. My prayer to God is, where is the church again at this time? It's not a time to go into hiding. It's not a time for us to act like everybody. It's a time to connect and get some solutions downloaded into our system. It's a time to go out there and be exemplary. I want people to come to me and say, like Isaac, how is it that everybody can't find any water in no wells? How is it that you have water? You don't know. I have connections. You want to join me in those connections? This is a time for great testimony. This is a time for great testimony. As I finish, I go back into 1 Corinthians 14. He says, even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sound, how will it be known what is piped or played? In your praise, in your worship, what are you trying to say? What message are you sending out? There's got to be a distinction. Some of us, when we worship, if we are happy, nobody knows it. If we are sad, nobody knows it. If we are worried, nobody knows it. It's not reflected in anything that we do. Everything is on the same tone. Everything is on the same level. However, listen to scripture. Does not God use words like rejoice? Does not He use words like sing unto the Lord a joyful? He is making a distinction. A joyful. Does he not, he say, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout to the Lord with the voice of triumph. Am I saying we must shout always? No. I'm just saying there is a time for it too. And the time to be sober. We must make a distinction. But you will when you make worship purposeful. When praise is purposeful. Praise is not about whether the song is fast or slow. It's about what you're communicating. He says, let a distinction come in. And last thing I'm going to say, and then we're going to practice what we've heard, is this. He says, praise me in the dance. I think it's Psalm 147. Do you know that your dance is an expression, it's a language all by itself? So I wonder when we were singing the song, he turned my morning, and you were going into dancing again. Lifted. Oh, some people didn't even bother. It's lifted my soul. What exactly language is this? Are you reading me, sir? Are you reading my language? I can't stay silent. I must sing for his... It doesn't matter if you don't know how to dance. A bad dance never killed the earth, you know? But dance has always been an expression of how people feel. That's why when you're down, you don't dance. When you go where I come from, and people at a funeral and they dance, they go, oh! That's it. But when they... Are you from Ghana? You have a Ghana smile. He really does. But when they're excited, have you seen people when they are happy and excited? There's an exhilaration. There's a looseness. There's a liberty. Oh, they express themselves in joyful ways. How come we don't express ourselves in joyful ways in that fashion? If we were to shut down the music in a moment, what would we do? He said, praise me in the dance. In other words, God says, I want to read your dance. Send me a message through your dance. In Ghana, we have Adoa. Adoa is a dance that you would have done very well, my brother, because the dance is controlled by the drummer. The drummer speaks. Did you know drums speak? Yes. Oh, I tell you, instruments must speak. If they didn't, talking drums. In Ghana, when they announce the news, they say, Ghana, Muntie, Ghana, listen. And they do it to the drum. Dun, 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 dun. And when you hear that, you know that it's news time. In the same way, God even said, blow the trumpet in Zion, that the people may gather. So Paul says, if your sound and your is not distinct, who knows how we ought to act? How will people know to gather for war, or to gather to hear, or to gather to listen, or to gather to do something? And so this dancer actually goes before the king, and she starts to dance, but she doesn't, and her dance is her adoration to the king, but she doesn't speak. And all she does is she stays in the before the king, and she does all the moves, and sometimes she can say, everything on earth belongs to you. You are the, you know, sometimes through her expressions in the dance, she can say, you are Lord, you are God, because we have that in our kingship, in our system of kingship, in that tribe, Ashanti tribe. And she will act everything out, and the king is reading the message. When we were younger, we used to go to these days they call them raves and so on, but discos. You know, when you're a girl and the man liked you, he didn't have to use many words, just the move said it all. Just the moves spoke. I wonder if your moves are speaking. Do you reckon their moves speak? Not all the time, yeah. Do you want their moves to speak? Do you know what I'm saying? It's got to speak. This is a house of hope. When people walk in, they got to know, why are these people joyful? Because we have hope, a favorable, confident expectation that our God won't let us down, that our God is waiting for us in the future. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because my God lives, all my fear is gone. Because he holds my future, my life is worth the living. Ah, because my God lives, because he lives. He chose the place he would die. He chose the moment he would die. Even in the midst of death, he was in control. With his last breath, he was able to say, it is finished. When he hung on that cross, they couldn't kill him. They couldn't break his bones. Ah, they went to this one. They broke that one's bones. They went to that one. They looked at him. But somehow, prophecy spoke. They passed over him. In the same way, I have a hope they will pass over me. You understand? They will not touch me. When he hung on that cross, he asked for water according to the word that had been written years before, 700 years before. They would put vinegar in his mouth instead of water. When the Roman soldier came, he asked for water. He gave him vinegar exactly according to his word. Don't mess with my God. He watches over his word to perform it. It may be over several centuries, over several decades, but that word, that promise to me stands sure and true. Excuse me if I dance a little bit. I have a hope to face Monday morning. I don't know what Monday holds, but I know the God who holds my Monday, because whatever he said, he will surely keep me in perfect peace. If my mind is stayed on him, he says, I will be with you. If you dwell in the secret place of the Most High, he will abide with you under his shadow. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. He will preserve your soul even forevermore. Excuse me if I clap today, because I know a God who is waiting for me in the future. Excuse me if I jump a little bit, because I know my problem, there's a solution coming. Excuse me if Haman rises against me today, I'm not intimidated. I know a God who can use a sexy babe to bring to nothing what his plans are. Excuse me this morning. Excuse me. There's got to be a difference, people. I just want to praise you. I want to lift. You know what? When you're singing like that, nobody knows what you're doing. But you know what you're doing. I'm going to lift my hands and say, hey, God, if it wasn't for you, you know where that marriage would have been. That I love you because you. Oh, excuse me this morning, Safis. I seem a bit crazy. I was minding my own business, right? As the kids say. Had an email come to my office. They asked me, would you like to go to the UN and participate? Excuse me, this dumb girl from Africa. The Lord will exalt you. When they say there's a casting down, he said, just lift up your mouth and say there's a lifting up. It's a God who can take you places where you never dreamt. Excuse me! Hebrews chapter 2, verse 12. He says, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. This is Jesus speaking. And again, are you there? Let's read from verse 11. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are one. For which reason? And he, Jesus, is the one who sanctifies. And we are the ones who are being sanctified. For which reason he is not ashamed to call us brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. When we praise God, Jesus joins in. The spirit of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. He begins to show us who God is. He begins to open our prophetic eyes. How many of you, when you're praising God, feel God more than ever before? There's a reality of God in your life. When you worship, because you attract, the spirit of prophecy comes. And he says, I will declare your name. What is God's name? It's a man's nature. It's who he is. It is glory. It's the length, the breadth, the depth, and the height of his love for you. And he says, in the midst of the praise, I will show up. You notice in the midst of the announcements, he don't quite do that. As necessary as that is, I just want to create an environment for him to be magnified. Can we do that this morning? Can we do that with a clap? Time didn't allow me to tell you all this. No, I didn't say clap. I'm just saying, can we do that this morning as we go into just 2 minutes of praising him? Can we do that with a dance? Can we do that with a smile? Can we do that with a shout? You're handling your future right now. The enemy is listening. He's got to back off something that belongs to you. You know, every day is a day of expectation. Every day is a day of hope. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard what the Lord has reserved for you. It's out there. It's waiting. It's your battleground. You know, the Bible says, he's all hail the Lamb enthroned on high. His praise shall be my battle cry. His name is Jesus, forever glorious, lifted up. Stand to your feet right now, please. As you worship him, I want you to put your challenge before God. As you worship him, you know what? Your worship is also your opinion about God. One of my favorite songs is, Lord, I believe. That's my opinion. Great is thy faithfulness is an opinion about God. Your opinion is going to work for you. God likes what is here. It's going to work for you this afternoon. I like what we sang before. What did we sing? Where there once was no earth, he turned my mourning into Yeah, he's turned my morning. How many of you have any morning that needs to be turned around this morning? And for all you Africans out there who believe that there's a witch somewhere out there in the village, well, witchcraft is true. But you know, I wanted to tell you something. We don't have time for me to open it. It just occurred to me. Isaiah, I think 33, talks about this. When I reached out for the banner, he says with harps and tambourines, God said he's going to punish Assyria concerning you. Can you come up a little bit? I promise not to hit too hard. Come on. Come up quickly. Assyria is your enemy. God is going to judge your enemy. God is going to deal with the enemy that's trying to stop your breakthrough and stop you from breaking out. He says as he judges Assyria, he says the rod of punishment on the seat of education. He said the rod of punishment that he lays upon Assyria's back will be by tambourines and harps. Did you hear me? Do you want me to read it for you to believe, or do you believe my word? Because you know when I'm gone, Pastor D is going to check me out, right? He said, listen, I'm wasting time. We've got to go home. But he said, everything, place where the rod of punishment will be laid, this rod will become your tambourines, your singing, and your drums, your keyboard, and your harps. Aren't you glad that God made it easy for you? Aren't you just glad that you don't have to manufacture, that nobody has to do it for you, that there's power within you to effect change? And finally, I'm going to tell you this story. It's a true story because I want your faith level to be up high. I don't want you to just worship. I want you to place your challenge before you. It's a prophetic exercise. You're going to deal with that mountain. You're going to say to it, you're going to go. In the face of my God, you will get out of my face. And then you're going to even stir up yourself to ask for greater things. Don't stay focused on your challenge right now. You're going to stir up some things to ask for greater things. A story is told of a little boy. Thank you, dear. This young boy is in a hostel. He's a bad boy. He's in a hostel. And he goes to Mother Superior. And he says, Mother Superior, please, can I have a red new bike? And Mother Superior says, well, you know, Johnny, you've been very bad. You have to ask Jesus. If you tell Jesus you're going to be good for 3 months, he will let you have that bike. So Johnny goes, thinks about it. He's never been good for 3 minutes. How's he going to be good for 3 months? Anyway, he asks Jesus, please, send me a red bike. I promise I'll be good for 3 months. And Jesus, it's quiet. And he realizes it's not going to happen. So he works, he negotiates something with Jesus for a long time till he gets to like 1 day, 3 minutes, 3 hours. It doesn't work. He wants that red bike now. He's so frustrated and desperate, and I hope somebody gets desperate this morning enough to do something drastic, that he looks around the room, and all he sees is a statue of Mary, the mother of Jesus. He picks up that statue, wraps it up in his bedsheet, puts it under his pillow, looks up to the heavens and says, Dear Lord Jesus, if you want to see your mother again, let me have the red bike now. Maybe somebody ought to get that desperate this morning, because I am. Anybody believe in God for something that looks impossible? Lift up your hand. Oh, we believe he's able. He's able. He's able. I believe God had respect upon that prayer, man. If you're desperate enough to do something, heaven will respond to you. Now, I'm desperate enough to let my inhibitions loose, to dance like I've never danced so that heaven can respond. Let's go. Let's go. The Bible says that to everything in your life, there is a season. Once God told Once Jesus told his people, when you go out to preach, don't take anything with you. Just take whatever is in your hand, your word, and settle wherever you go. When they did that, they were successful. And then at the end of his life, he says, remember the first instruction I gave you? Forget that. Now, if you don't have a sword, go sell everything and buy one. If you have a bag, pick it up. When do you know when the instruction has changed? It depends on when you recognize that your season has changed. Skillful living. God bless you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. Before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.